Three physicists have won the 2023 Nobel Prize for creating light pulses on the order of attoseconds. That's 1 times 10 to the negative 18 seconds long. To put that into perspective, there are more attoseconds in a second than there have been seconds in the age of the universe, which is 13.8 billion years old. To understand and acknowledge how important this discovery is, you must first understand why physicists were attempting it, how they were able to do it, and the revolutionary applications of this discovery. For this, we must first understand how a typical camera works. A typical camera works using a shutter, which lets in light for a short period of time, which is processed and creates an image. For video, these images are just combined together at a high frequency, which when shown quickly in succession, appear like a moving image. The frequency at which these photos are shown is called the FPS, or frames per second, of the image. Now, if you've ever taken a photo of a fast-moving object, like a fast-moving soccer ball or a bee, you'll notice that there's a blur in the image, often referred to as motion blur. This blur occurs as the object being filmed is moving, meaning the shutter, which lets in light for a certain duration of time, captures the light from the object at several different points, creating the blur. In the case of the bee flaps its wings at a frequency of 230 beats per second, meaning that if your FPS, or frames per second, is 30 or 60 FPS, as is the standard in most cameras, each frame will capture more than two flaps, creating motion blur. This blur also translates over to video, which is just these images combined together. Therefore, to film a bee flapping its wings, you would need a camera that shoots at above 230 FPS. To film motions that are faster or occur in shorter periods of time, you need a shutter that turns on and off faster and faster. But at some point, around the microsecond timescale, you just physically can't create a faster shutter. To solve this, a new technique for taking videos was created, where short strobes of light would be flashed on the subject, the light of which would be reflected off the subject and it would return back to the camera. There would be no shutter, but the subject would only be illuminated for a short period of time, dependent on the duration of the strobe of light. This meant that the FPS of the video was now purely limited to the duration of that strobe of light. Over time, light pulses were created that pulsed for shorter and shorter durations of time, now using lasers instead of typical light. And over time, we got down to the femtosecond. The attosecond timescale, though, was a new milestone. This is because most electromagnetic interactions occur on the attosecond timescale. This means that using attosecond pulses of light, we can now video the motion of electrons. This includes the rearrangement of electrons and therefore charges inside the atom, electrons being excited by photons, and lots more. Next, though, we have to understand how physicists were able to create light pulses so short. Creating attosecond pulses is not easy, so physicists had to be clever. To successfully create the attosecond timescale light pulses, they devised a two-step method. First, they had to use a method called high harmonic generation to create attosecond light pulses. To perform this method, light from a high-frequency femtosecond laser is shined into a certain type of noble gas, typically argon or neon. This already high-frequency light hits the electrons in the argon atoms. The electrons then absorb the high-frequency photons, which carry lots of energy and are freed from the atom, allowing them to float around in the vacuum. Then, due to the high laser frequency, the rapid oscillation and strong electromagnetic fields created by the laser will quickly accelerate the electron back to its original atom, causing the electron to reconnect with it. The electron typically comes back with more energy than what is needed for it to be recaptured by the atom, and in the process, it releases the excess energy in even higher frequency light bursts, which are simply multiples, aka harmonics, of the original frequency. This phenomena, called recollision, was discovered in the 1980s by Elmehed's team and is essential for creating attosecond level light pulses. The second part was to take all the different frequencies emitted by the gas and then lining them up so that they would align and the peaks would add up with certain peaks while the troughs would cancel out certain peaks, to create extremely short, high-intensity, attosecond-level light pulses. This was first achieved in 2001 by Agostini's team, but the problem was that these light pulses were too close together to be used for any practical experimental purposes. Krauss's team, though, had developed techniques for creating these separated attosecond-level light pulses, and in 2001 was the first person to pass the 1,000 attosecond barrier, creating light pulses that were only 650 attoseconds long while keeping them spaced out for experimental purposes. This was revolutionary, as for the first time, attosecond-level light pulses were possible. Ever since the original breakthrough, though, scientists have continued to try to get shorter and shorter pulses of light, and the current record stands at 43 attoseconds. The question now becomes, how do you use these extremely short pulses of light to video these electrons, and what are the possible applications of this? To do this, physicists had to devise yet another technique called pump probe spectroscopy to video the electrons. This works very similar to the way strobing lights work, but for electrons, and consists of two separate steps, the pump and then the probe. The first part of this technique, the pump, is where a stronger laser is used to excite the electrons, causing them to move or oscillate, which is the motion that is going to be videoed. The second part, the probe, is where the attosecond light bursts are shined via laser at the electrons. The information then obtained by the light is measured using complex techniques, and the information is used to determine the position of the electrons. Then, by changing the delay time between the pump and the probe light bursts, the position of the electrons at a different point in the movement is measured. And after doing this over and over again, the locations of the electrons in each measurement or frame, which occur at different points in time, can be combined together to reconstruct or create a video of the electron's motion. This means that now, because of the creation of attosecond light pulses, the movement of electrons within the atom can be highly and accurately measured, something that could never be done before. This discovery has a wide variety of applications. To begin with, by capturing the motion of these electrons, we can better understand electron dynamics, or the way electrons move, which is key to certain chemical reactions. And by doing this, we can much better understand and possibly even manipulate the reactions. This discovery can also be used to help create much faster electronics. This can be done by creating much faster and more efficient transistors. Typical transistors change from neutral to conducting at the picosecond timescale, and using attosecond light pulses, we can possibly get that down close to or even at the attosecond timescale. The difference between picosecond and attosecond is a 100,000 times difference. This means that even if we get a portion of this improvement, it would still have a wide variety of impacts and could help us make electronics much, much, much more efficient. Most chip manufacturers use extreme ultraviolet light to create very tiny transistors on the scale of nanometers. But by using attosecond level light pulses, they can create even smaller transistors, meaning we can fit more transistors on this chip and therefore make electronics faster, saving Moore's law for a little bit longer. If you want to learn more about electron dynamics, click right here to watch my video on the photoelectric effect. If you like this video, click right here to subscribe to my channel. And if you have any questions, put them down in the comments. That's it for today. I'm Zaid, and I'll see you next time on The Universe with Physics.